historic Churchill Downs in Louisville, Kentucky. Under the famed twin spires, it's Breeders' Cup Day, a rich climax to the 1988 racing year. And today, before an expected crowd of 60,000, the best thoroughbreds from the United States and Europe compete in $7 million races. Preparation, beauty, solitude, hope, intensity, strength. In sport, greatness can often be defined in those power words. It really is defining sport in its simplest terms. And in thoroughbred racing, 1 year ago, we had a classic mix. We all benefited from this moment of athletic poetry. The sun isn't shining bright on my old Kentucky home. It's rained hard in Louisville the last 2 days, and rain is in the forecast. It'll be the first time the Breeders' Cup races have been run on an off track. The current word is a sloppy track, the dirt track here at famed Churchill Downs. And as one of the trainers said as he looked up at the twin spires behind me, this is magic. And so will this day of 4 hours of classic racing as we celebrate the sport of kings. And Tom Hammond, who has, run the full spectrum from groom to announcer to owner, joins us. It's a great day, but certainly there'll be a lot of bright stars to liven things up.
There will, and in fact, this is part of horse racing and off track, and it's the riders and the horses that adapt the best to come away the winners, and it is a bright cast. I think the best in the 5 years of the Breeders' Cup, all the best horses in training in the U.S. and Europe are here, and an intriguing battle for Horse of the Year. Personal ends in the filly who will run in the distaff. She has raced twice on a sloppy track and done well. Ali Sheba, who will go in the Classic, has not run well on an off track, and his chances for Horse of the Year may be hurt today.
All right, Ali Sheba, who won the Kentucky Derby 2 years ago here at Churchill Downs and is looking to become the winningest in terms of earnings horse in history, passing John Henry.
Number one horse in the field today, the lesser half of the Wayne Lucas trained entry, fifth in the sprint last year at 97-1, riding a 5-race losing streak, Chris Antley with his first Breeders' Cup ride. Number 1A is Gulch. Lucas leads all trainers with 6 Breeders' Cup wins. Gulch is best shot here. Racing in top company has not been out of the money in 10 starts this year. Angel Cordero figures to keep Gulch just off the pace, and Gulch retires after today.
Very Settled returns to defend the sprint championship won at Hollywood Park last year, went off at 16-1, is 15-1 currently.
She is a long shot today. She hasn't won since that Breeders' Cup victory, except once, as trainer Mel Studi tried to stretch her out to longer races. Number 3, Rule Man, a Kentucky Derby contender until injured in April, had surgery to remove knee chips and is 2-for-2 in New York since his return. Gary Stevens looks for his first Breeders' Cup win. Number 4, A Fleet, like Gulch, unplaced in last year's Classic, this year tries the sprint, has not raced in 4 months after a series of minor ailments, but typically runs well fresh and has Lasix for the first time today. He retires to stud after this race. Number 5, Mossa, formerly raced in England, but has 5 U.S. wins this year, comes from way back, but can he do that in a race this short? This is his shortest effort of the year. Number 6, Once Wild, was scratched. Number 7, Precisionist, making his third Breeders' Cup appearance. He won the sprint at Aqueduct on his way to champion sprinter honors. Retired to stud in 1987 by his owner, 91-year-old Fred Hooper. Precisionist failed to get his mares in fold and has returned to the races this year. 3 wins and 6 starts, but all at longer distances. Chris McCarron's only Breeders' Cup score was on this horse. Number 8 is Calistoga. He's won 5 of his last 6. He loves the slop. He hasn't raced against this kind of competition, though. He's trying to crack the big time with Don Brumfield, leading rider of all time at Churchill Downs. Number 9, Olympic Prospect. Frank Sinatra is one of the owners, but not the Frank Sinatra. There may be singing, but it's likely to be off-key. The owner is a Glendale, California pediatrician. But this is a real speedball. He'll be Catch Me If You Can today. He's the California Invaders, taken 6 of 7.
And the big crowd fancies Mining, currently the favorite at 9 to 5.
Favorite because he's unbeaten, though he's raced only 6 times, had ankle chips removed. He has been well in the slop. He won in Novosburg in the mud his last start, beating Gulch nearly 3 lengths. Number 11, Play the King, Canadian-based, has won 4 of 5 this year, breaks from the outside post position. In the mutual field, 2 horses today running as 1 betting interest. Number 12, Ready Jet Go, second filly in the field, equaled the 6-furlong track record of the Meadowlands in her last start. Linda Rice Appleby, daughter of the owner, is trainer, groom, exercise rider, hot walker, and van driver for this filly. Number 13 is Sylvan Express, a closer, second and third to Olympic Prospect this summer. His last race in the slop at Keeneland, a disaster. He finished 7th.
A field of 13 sprinters, the best in the world, going here at Churchill Downs, and these are the current odds. You'll see them throughout the day as they are on the Totalizator here at Churchill Downs. The entry of High Brighton Gulch at 5-1, Very Subtle at 15-1, went off at 16-1 last year in the win, and there's your favorite, number 10, Mining, at 9-5. Good backing for Olympic Prospect, number 9, at 6-1. They like Precisionist and Calistoga at 7-1. They're on the track for the 6-furlong sprint. Despite the 50-degree weather, 72,000 now the estimate. Churchill Downs, $1 million sprint at 6 furlongs, 3/4 of a mile to start at the head of the backstretch, home stretch here, 1/4 of a mile, one of the longest stretches in American racing, certainly lending to the drama of all of this day's racing. The sprint, the equine equivalent of the 100-meter dash. Well, the equivalent of the Sunshine Boys? No way. The terrible twosome. On this day, maybe the Cloudburst Kids are with us again. Let's go to Jay Randolph and Harvey Peck.
Dick, Daddy Warbucks is here with me, and we are ready to go. The weather is not very good, as you've mentioned, but nevertheless, when there's horse racing in Kentucky, it is always dandy. Today, we'll be talking about the race behind the race before each event on the card, Harvey.
And in the event of this race, this is the best betting race on the card, but remember, it's mud. We're going to show you the race behind the race, give you some sort of a clue, but remember, this is a beauty. This is wide open.
And Harvey indicates to you that it's a very important start today. Here's our look now at the sprint and the race behind the race.
Speed Will Out, Very Subtle, won this race in California last year in fine fashion.
She's not the same filly, but she's freshened, and that's the way she likes it. There's Rule Man, once considered a prospect for the Derby, came back sprinting recently, and he was dynamite.
Olympic Prospect, the big, powerful gelding, has won 6 of 7. And let's go back to Santa Anita last month and the ancient title.
Olympic Prospect, the best in the West, fastest horse in America out of the gate. Any of these speedballs that wants the lead is in trouble today.
Dwayne Lucas has been pointing Gulch toward this race all year. He's not been worse than second in races under a mile. Mining, lightly raced. Six races, six wins for Denny Phipps. And he and Gulch went at it for seven furlongs in the Vosburgh at Belmont last month.
There's Gulch coming along the inside. He's caught Mining. Mining is under the whip. Watch Mining toy with him. Begin to pull away. He's laughing at Gulch. Mining will be your favorite today. He's never faced this big a field. He's drawn an outside post. He deserves to be the favorite, but he's beatable. If you like to bet on horses, this is your race. The best betting race on the card.
The best betting race on the card, and we've got Pax Pool back again this year. The National Broadcasting Company, the sports division, presenting Harvey with a Franklin, $100. What are you going to do right off the bat in what you say is the best betting race of the day?
I've been here 3 days with you. I know it's not you $100.
Somebody you're right
gave
there.
Now, this is the kind of race that if you're betting, you buck six horses and hope. I can't do that. I have to make one bet. I'm going to make a big bet only because I like the betting race. I'm betting $25 on a Fleet. I don't know if a Fleet can handle Mud. I know he may like an off-track, he may not. He's my shot. If he wins, I can go home.
And ladies and gentlemen, that is a major move to start off Pax Pool.
So a Fleet, ridden by Gary Stahlbaum. The number four in this Breeders' Cup sprint is Harvey Pax Pick. Of course, the start of this race is critical. Tom Hammond.
It is critical, Dick. In fact, in the first four sprints, the winner's been on top the first quarter mile and never worse than third. Twice they've been on top the first quarter. The interesting thing here will come from post positions 12 and 13. In 12 is Olympic Prospect. He figures to go out and work his way toward the rail. I don't think anybody can head him. And then the favorite, Mining, comes out of 13 in post 13. Look for Mining to follow Olympic Prospect, settle just off the pace right behind Olympic Prospect as he works his way to the rail. That's the way the start, which is crucial in this race, should go today.
We're joined also again for Breeders' Cup Day with a Supreme Rider with the Sunday Times and our commentator in all of our Breeders' Cup Classics, Bruff Scott.
It's great to be with you all again and great to be down at the start before the sprint where it's absolutely crucial. I've talked to the starter. He says number nine, Olympic Prospect, with a speed horse with Lafitte Pink Eye. He got very nervous in the stalls the last time he saw him. Watch him because he's got to come out and he's going to lead.
Bruff Scott, how do you feel the sloppy track will affect this speed race?
Well, of course, if anything is behind, he are going to get absolutely covered, really covered. And anything that leads, we think they may well hold on.
And the wind you could hear as well in the microphones, Tom Hammond. How about the wind gusting up to 30 miles an hour?
A tailwind on the backstretch is going to mean some very fast early fractions. Look for Olympic Prospect to fly on the lead.
We're reminded of the stirring call of the Classic last year. Now let's go up to the top race announcer in the country, Tom Durkin.
And we're ready for the start of the first Breeders' Cup in Kentucky. And they're off. Gulch broke alertly on the outside. Calistoga is away quickly. Mining was also away well. And toward the inside, it's very subtle in Olympic Prospect. Olympic Prospect and very subtle. And those two will fight it out early. And Mining is right there and fighting early in third. Precisionist is hustled up on the inside. Fourth, Calistoga fifth on the outside. Roman is up close. He's just five lengths off the lead. Play the King is now running seventh on the outside. And then it's Gulch now racing in eighth position. Then farther back, Ready Jet Go is now ninth toward the rail. High Bright is racing in tenth. A Fleet, the Canadian, is 11th. Then on the extreme outside, it's Sylvan Express, and Mossif now is launching his bid from the back of the pack. The quarter was a quick one, 21 seconds flat, and it is Olympic Prospect now who comes to the top of the stretch with the lead by a length. Last year's winner, very subtle now, running at him from the inside. Precisionist is right there, racing in third position, and in between horses, Gulch is right there, fourth. On the outside, Play the King down there, down to the final furlong. Very subtle has now taken the lead. On the outside, Play the King is charging hard. Gulch is right there, Gulch emerging with the lead. Play the King, it's Gulch, Play the King, here's the wire, and Gulch has won it. And a salute of victory from Angel Cordero Jr. Gulch coming from slightly off the pace, and he goes on to outgame Play the King in the Breeders' Cup Sprint.
Angel Cordero aboard the late-running sprinter. He wanted a fast pace and got it on this sloppy track at Churchill Downs. The four-year-old Kentucky-bred Gulch is the winner. of the Breeders' Cup Million Dollar Sprint, sired by the 19-year-old great sire, Mr. Prospector. Angel, congratulations. You've got
Thank
one
you.
In the bank.
Thank you. This is my birthday present.
And how do you think the track will affect the longer races that we're about to see?
Thank you, Chris.
Angel, talking to you.
Angel, how about the longer races as we get to the dirt races over a mile? How will the track affect those?
The track is soft. The grass is soft, but the dirt is good.
It's tough, but very quick, and certainly the speed of Gulch down the stretch with Angel Cordero guiding the winner, $450,000 to the winning sprinter, Gulch. The unofficial winner, Gulch, you heard Angel Cordero say that it's an early birthday present for him. He'll be 46 years old in 3 days. Gulch, unofficially on top, went off at 5-1 as part of the entry. Play the King and a Fleet. And very subtle, last year's winner finished fourth. A Fleet was flying on the rail.
He was indeed. And Gulch out away from the rail. He's wide here. You see him in the green colors with the white shadow roll on his nose, overtaking Very Subtle and Olympic Prospect, holding off Play the King. And in on the rail, watch a Fleet at this move in the final 16th of a mile. But it's Gulch giving Cordero his second Breeders' Cup triumph. He won for trainer Wayne Lucas on Life's Magic back in the distaff in 1985. Here's the head-on view. Here's Gulch now with a white shadow roll on, being whipped right-handed by Cordero, moving between horses there with Play the King on his outside, Olympic Prospect on his inside. Cordero switches the whip to his left hand, beating furiously and alternating with a hand ride, and gets Gulch up to win it. This is a third time the charm for Gulch. He was fifth in the 1986 Breeders' Cup Juvenile, ninth in the 87 Classic, and Cordero celebrates a victory in the 88 Sprint.
Well, some big prices on the board with Play the King a long shot finishing second. That'll create a $582 exacta. Those are musical terms for Jay and Harvey.
Well, Harvey did a pretty good job. He kind of liked the four a little bit, but Harvey, it's Peter Brandt's charge that gets home.
Well, Peter Brandt, we picked Gulch last year in the Classic, no win. What happened in the Vosburgh? You took dead aim at Mining and then the horse hung.
Well, I think he was coming off a mile in an eighth race, and he probably wasn't as sharp, and I think Wayne was really getting him ready for this Breeders' Cup sprint, and just great honor, great field of horses, and this is the ultimate honor for a horse.
You sure did, and you were pointing him for this most of the year.
Right, this was the ultimate goal all the time. We really thought that he was the best sprinter in the country, and we stretched him out a little bit, and certainly that dulled him, but I told Peter we'd have him ready for six furlongs this time.
You did,
Wayne,
have him.
You were watching on the replay as Cordero did his job. He really got into this horse.
I thought we'd probably have to pay him time and a half for that, because he did a beautiful job. I mean, we were concerned early on that he was too far back, but when they threw up the 21, we said we're okay. And when he got through between horses, I almost jumped the rail myself to help him. It was wonderful.
Nice way to start your day.
Oh boy, this is something else. I'm so happy to be able to win one for Peter. He's been so cooperative and stayed with us all year and believed in our program. And for us to win one for this guy right here means a lot.
You also must have been pretty happy the track came up like this. This is Gulch's kind of track.
I had said earlier that I thought the three Mr. Prospectors had the best shot to win the race, whichever, a Fleet, Mining, or this horse here. And I think that sometimes when a track's like this, the pedigree gets very, very important.
Well, it was a super race. Everything turned out okay for you. A year late for me, but that doesn't matter. We congratulate you both.
Thank you. It's a thrill. I think I'll watch this over and over.
You can see Cordero.
He's pumping and working, isn't he?
Sure.
Right
did.
Here, I knew the little horse wouldn't give up. Maybe the mile and eighth here, Peter helped us in the end. That's pretty. That's pretty.
Well, thank you both very much, and congratulations. It's always nice to win this first one, Wayne.
Thank you. We're trying to get along with it.
Wayne Lucas, who will be back with five entries in the Juvenile Fillies in the next race. That's his seventh win as trainer, and that is a Breeders' Cup record, and here are the official results.
Gulch, $13.60, $6.460. Long Shot, Play the King, $27.40, $13.20. A Fleet was third. The exact payoff, look at this, a $2 wager gets you $582.40.
Oh, my. Well, once again, the celebrated daily racing form cartoonist Peb joins us with his special look at racing, especially in the sprints. How many times have you wished that your horse could get out quicker? And we'll return after these words from your local station. Citation with Eddie R. Caro. Citation, the winner on his way to the treasures of the Triple Crown. It would be 25 years after Citation before racing would salute its next Triple Crown winner, 1973. Secretariat would win the Big Three. But it was Citation in 1948, and in the first race today, Breeders' Cup Sprint goes to Gulch. And the trophy presentation, Ted Bassett, the president of the Breeders' Cup Limited, to owner Peter Brandt. And Angel Cordero with his early birthday present. Gulch, the winner of the $1 million sprint. Greg Lewis joins us for this 1988 Breeders' Cup Day. He's on the infield.
Okay. Well, Dick, there are lots of ways to have a good time here at Churchill Downs on Breeders' Cup Day. Besides just betting the horses, you can come into the infield for a $2 general admission ticket and enjoy something that's being called a Kentucky Sampler. That's what all these people are doing here. What does that mean? It is a celebration of all that is Kentucky, a big festival. We've got bluegrass music going on over here just beside us. There are Kentucky foods. We've got catfish sandwiches, which are yummy, and odds are 5-3 that Jay Randolph would like me to bring him one. We've also got something here called burgoo, which is a stew they make in Kentucky. It's got everything you've got in the kitchen thrown into it, and it's supposed to be quite tasty. Also, 35 different booths featuring Kentucky crafts. And some people say here that this is the man with the best advice on how to bet these races. I think Harvey Pack would disagree. They're expecting 60,000 people here, maybe a few less than that, because we're getting a sample of something that isn't typically Kentucky right now. That's cold weather. But all of us here having a good time, yes?
Yeah!
Okay, Dick. Back to you.
Indeed, they're having a good time. And despite the weather, the love for racing in Kentucky reflected in the fact that we expect over 70,000 now. Juvenile Fillies next, a mile and a 16th, $1 million purse. And you see a rare moment in racing, a five-horse entry, five fillies under Wayne Lucas, the trainer, Darby Shuffle, Leah Lucinda, Open Mind, Some Romance, One of a Klein, named after the owner Gene Klein, at 3-5, the morning line, approved to fly at 20-1. Also in the field, Seattle Meteor has been scratched. Eloquent Minister at 5-1. Coach Chelsea 30-1. Another long shot stocks up. Sequay, maybe this is the kind of weather as we feel some sprinkles, at 12-1 from Florida. And a Firm Classic at 6-1. Now to Jay and Harvey.
Well, Dick, we have a five-horse entry coming up for Dwayne Lucas here, and it's a very unusual situation.
It certainly is. He almost didn't want to leave here to stay for the interview. The problem with it hurts because they have to be coupled in the betting because it's the same trainer. That's the law. So a lot of these horses, or some of the horses in the entry, haven't got much of a chance. But the best bet of all is to bet on at the show. They have to give you $2.10 for your $2. That's 5%. So if you bet $2, you'll collect your first ticket, win a dime. However, if you're at a track or at a simulcast or anywhere, and somebody wants to stand on line to bet $2 to show, give them a dime and tell them to sit down.
Sage advice from Mr. Pack.
Well, let's correct something right now. Seattle Meteor has not been scratched. The number three, Seattle Meteor, has not been scratched. That was some false information. Now let's go to the rest of our experts here at Churchill Downs.
Sharon Smith along with Bruff Scott. Bruff, of course, representing European racing here. And interestingly, in this two-year-old filly race, there is a filly who was raced in Europe, raced in the United States. She is going to face interesting track conditions here because of the rain today. What is your assessment of how she will handle the race, Eloquent Minister,
well,
and the track itself?
It is unique for a filly like her because she's actually run in these sort of conditions. She knows about going on dirt. She's been to England and indeed to Ireland, so she's about the most cosmopolitan girl in the field. But whether she's going to be good now, I don't know. The trouble is that you take decisions on one race, and then it's going to rain, and to pontificate too much, I think, is very dangerous. The answer is the fastest horse is going to win, and that's what happens worldwide.
Interestingly, though, the track is not as slow as we might think. We look out there and see all this mud, and we know we wouldn't want to get into it, but these horses in the sprint ran a respectable race.
Oh, yes, and I went up to the jocks room beforehand, and they said, some of the local jocks told me that they'd packed it down, they rode it a lot, they'd packed it down very hard, and so they actually, when they go through it, they're hitting a pretty fast surface. Indeed, makes horses very sore.
Of course, Bruff is also watching closely in the turf course, because we do have two turf races coming up a little bit later on. So a lot of question marks today about track conditions and some mysterious horses, including the filly Eloquent Minister, who will be racing on something a little bit different right now.
As you can see, the light showers now falling here in Louisville will dampen some of the spirits, but not of this horse player. He wasn't a sprinter, but he sure got the job done. The manager and Hall of Famer to be Pete Rose. Hey, good to have the Cincinnati Red Skipper with us.
And I think he is one of the many owners of Bet Twice. I think he has an ownership share in Bet Twice, who will be racing today in the mile.
Tom, the fact that Lucas has five starters in this juvenile fillies. He had four last year, and we thought that was quite something. With five, how does one divvy up his time? Where does he favor? How does he convince owners that he really is giving everyone equal training support?
Well, Wayne has a vast stable, Dick, spread out all over the country, and he has a man in charge at each of those sites. In fact, in this area, his son Jeff Lucas is in charge, and look at the five-horse entry. In fact, it wouldn't be in some states an entry as one betting interest. California, for instance, they would be divided by owners, but here in Kentucky, if one trainer has more than one horse in the race, it is all coupled as one betting interest. Gene Klein looking on as Wayne saddles Some Romance. Now, how he decided which one he would personally saddle, I don't know. We'd have to ask him, but he is saddling Gene Klein's Some Romance in the paddock, and he has some assistant trainers, including, I'm sure, his son Jeff, saddling the other members of this entry.
Gene Klein with Open Mind, Some Romance, and One of a Klein. Al McGuire is here in Louisville this weekend, our basketball buddy. He goes back to Wisconsin days when Lucas was a high school basketball coach, and Al said, I told him to stay in coaching. Don't be crazy enough to go into racing. You don't know with all the unexpected traps in that business. He could still be making $10,000 a year.
Well, he's been the leading trainer 5 years in a row. He's way out in front on the money one. There's Jeff Lucas, Wayne's son, and there's Wayne himself. Nice hat, by the way. And what is really amazing, last year and again this year, Lucas, as the leading trainer, has amassed more purse money than the leading jockey, which is unprecedented in American racing history.
Sharon Smith is in the paddock area.
You know, one of the reasons that a trainer does well is that he will try things with a horse. Leah Lucinda, the number 1A part of his entry, is going today in blinkers for the first time. She's a 2-year-old filly. She hasn't been concentrating very well on her races. So they're going to try the blinkers today to see if that is going to work to make her concentrate. Jeff Lucas did indeed just saddle her. He's going down the line with the rest of the five horses in the Wayne.
Where's the speed in this race, Tom?
Well, I'll tell you what, there are a number of fillies in here that have speed, and Darby Shuffle has speed, Eloquent Minister, Some Romance, One of a Client, so three of the Lucas horses show speed, and all week we've been seeing the speed really hold up. There's been a track bias here at Churchill Downs favoring the speed. However, the track is sloppy, and in the last race, Gulch came from off the pace, so perhaps that track bias lessened by the conditions today.
And if it should rain, obviously the track will become slower and will benefit those horses coming from off the speed.
Well, Dick, this Churchill Downs track has a lot of clay in it, and it's unlike some other racetracks in that the water mostly stays on top of the track. They sealed the track this morning. They didn't allow horses to work on it in the early hours today, and so most of the water has been kept from the base of the track. The water are mostly on top while the bottom of it is still firm, although we have noticed the times getting slower as the race gets chopped up under use today.
And there's a piece of history for you, Breeders' Cup history. Julie Crone will be aboard the one horse in that entry, Darby Shuffle, owned by Joseph Allen and trained by Lucas, the first woman to ever ride in a Breeders' Cup race. Julie Crone aboard, and of course she'll have 49er in the $3 million classic that will wrap up these seven great races in Louisville.
In fact, she has a She also rides Dr. Bizarre in the juvenile. She is the leading female rider. She is the winningest female jockey ever, and she looks for a Breeders' Cup win aboard one of the members of that favored entry at 4-5.
She's quite a dynamo, too. Apparently, she's been quick to use her fists when she doesn't like what some of the men have done to her. It's Chris McCarron aboard one of the Lucas entries.
And you notice they're wearing some new silks, aerodynamic form-fitting silks that we'll be talking about later in the program today. All the Lucas horses wearing them for Breeders' Cup events.
McCarron riding one of a Klein 1X. Let's go back to the official order of finish. And where did Mining, the unbeaten favorite, finally wind up?
Well, we see very subtle fourth defending her title. Precisionist just couldn't sprint with these horses. Made a little move at the top of the stretch, but one of the forward champions. He won the sprint in 85. Olympic Prospect, the speed ball. The speed didn't hold up. He faded to seventh. And there's Mining, 10th, suffering the first defeat of his career. It's likely he'll be retired to stud after this race. He had won six in a row. He'd had chips removed from an ankle, but a bad way to end what had been an unbeaten career. He winds up 10th for the Breeders' Cup Sprint. The horse is now entering the track for the juvenile fillies, and it's $1 million purse, with the Lucas entry continuing to be the heavy choice among the fans here at Churchill Downs. And number one, Darby Shuffle, has won two of her last three starts, but has not won a graded stake. And as we noted, she does provide Julie Crone with her first Breeders' Cup mount, the first female to compete in the Breeders' Cup. 1A is Leah Lucinda, owned by the famed Calumet Farm. She didn't like the Santa Anita surface when she was beaten 14 lengths by one of a Klein in the Oakleaf Stakes. 1C is Open Mind, has raced only four times, closing fast to just miss by a nose of catching Some Romance in the Grade 1 Frisette. She could become the first New Jersey bred to win a Breeders' Cup event.
Lucas said his eyes really got big when he thought Some Romance was going off too cheaply, bought as a yearling for $500,000.
She lost her first race, Dick, then she reeled off four in a row. Though she was life and death to hold on in the one-mile Frisette, today she'll try two turns for the first time. The final member of the entry, 1X, is One of a Klein, a play on the name of her owner, who paid $575,000 for it at the yearling sales, and a good investment. She's won two of three, including the Grade 1 Oakleaf, at this same mile and a 16th distance. Number two, Approved to Fly, in contrast to the blue-blooded Lucas fillies. Approved to Fly sold for $6,700 as a yearling. She began her racing career in Mexico and hasn't won since, though she was first and then disqualified in the Del Mar debutante. Number three, Seattle Meteor, fell to earth with a thud after a dull third in her last start at Keeneland, but she has been in the money five of six starts. She won the Grade 1 Spinaway in the Slop at Saratoga. Number four, Eloquent Minister, won her first two in Belmont in New York, then purchased by Robert Sangster, one of two in Europe racing there. Her trainer, Tommy Stack, is a former steeplechase jockey. Number five is Coke's Chelsea. Owner Elmer Miller has bought a new pair of silks for this race. He has a superstition of buying a new set of colors before every stakes race in which his horses compete. Coke's Chelsea has cost him for six sets already. I think they're going to get dirty, though, today. Number six is Stocks Up, second to One of a Klein in the Oakleaf, wears blinkers for the first time today. One of the owners, California banker Alan Pribble, has been to every Breeders' Cup Day, but this is the first horse he's owned.
How about this for a hunch bet, considering the weather, Tom? Sequay.
Sequay has made more starts, 12, than any other horse in the race. Her owners named the filly after development of condominiums in Vero Beach, Florida. And is this an omen? Those condos are the spring training home of several Los Angeles Dodgers, surprise winners of the World Series. And number eight is Affirmed Classic, lightly raced. She's been out only three times, with two wins in Louisiana and a good second at Keeneland, ridden by Pat Day, the number one Breeders' Cup jockey with four wins. And here are the current odds as the five-horse Lucas entry continues to reign as the favorite at 4-5. So 4-5 on the Lucas entry, which has gone up a bit. It opened at 3-5. Approved to Fly, one of the long shots, 45-1. Seattle Meteor, they like that race at Saratoga in the Slop. She's 7-2, and the second betting choice, Affirmed Classic, third choice at 5-1.
Well, Tom, from inspiration to strength to intensity, those are power words in this sport of the great equines, and we are going to demonstrate those to you and bring them to life as we follow these magnificent thoroughbreds throughout today. Preparation from breeding shed to winner's circle, from AM gallops to the sprint home in the ninth race. Owner, trainer, jockey, thoroughbred, preparation, keys, performance.
Welcome back to Churchill Downs. A dozen two-year-old fillies at a mile and a 16th in the million-dollar juvenile for the ladies. The race begins in front of the grandstand. It's a fairly short run to the first turn, a disadvantage for the horses like One of a Kind that have drawn an outside post. And for a look at the top fillies in the country, let's go to the race behind the race. Here's Harvey and Jay.
The ladies get together, and here's One of a Kind. This is only her fourth race. Lucas, Klein, McCarran. They can make some magic. Here's One of a Kind in the Oak Leaf, a mile and a 16th at Santa Anita.
This is a two-turn race, exactly as the one is today. She's an awfully good filly, and she's just part of a very powerful team.
And here's more of that handful, Some Romance. 1-4 of 5, and this horse loves to be on the lead. Here's Open Mind, 2 wins and 2 seconds in 4 starts. Some Romance and Open Mind got together in the Frisette at Belmont.
Going back to his roots, Dwayne Lucas, once a basketball coach, he's sending out 5 young ladies in this juvenile, and here's 2 of them. In this race, Some Romance figured to be the easy winner. Open Mind, nobody really liked her. Now watch Some Romance nearing the finish line. Is she tiring, or is the rider just letting up on her? I doubt very much if she was letting up on her, but here comes her stablemate, Open Mind. Now there's 2 more on the team.
Eloquent Minister may challenge. Robert Sangster now owns the Kentucky Bred, who's campaigned in the U.S. and the British Isles back in June at Belmont. Here's the action in the Garden City.
She wins this by 12 lengths. Looked like a real champion. Sangster took it England. Once on the turf, she lost, and then she won. She's back in Kentucky now, and she may be the challenger to Team Lucas.
Well, let's do the accounting. Harvey Pack picked a Fleet to finish first, bet $25 first race. A Fleet was third, so we have 75 left. How, Harvey, do you go against the 5 filly entry?
You just about don't go against it. If they were split, I'd go against them, because there's 5 of them. I won't really take a big shot. Eloquent Minister wasn't as fast as these when she left America. Maybe the Sangster people have done something with her. You see the size of that bet, $2 on Eloquent Minister.
You're not giving much credibility to that bet, are you?
What a guy. $2. Eloquent Minister at 9-1. The current odds as they approach the gate. 3-5 now on the 5 filly entry, approved to fly 40-1. Second choice of those wagering, Seattle Meteor at 7-2. Eloquent Minister 9-1. Coax Chelsea in stocks up, 35-21-1. Sequoia at 14-1. Affirm Classic, the third choice at 5-1.
And I would expect Some Romance to show the early speed, Dick. She's coming from one of the outside post positions, post position 10. And a couple of horses that come from off the pace could be in trouble. They're down on the inside. Approved to fly in post 1. And Leah Lucinda in post 3. You're going to have to use a little early speed to get position before they settle into stride to come from off the pace, as did Gulch in the first race of Breeders' Cup races here today.
Eloquent Minister, a little trouble going into the gate. There's Bruff Scott.
Yes, they're just getting loaded, and Derby Shuffle with Julie Crone already in stall 2. She's making history, but don't start saying any fancy words about a girl doing it. She's a real tough cookie, very talented rider, and she's already got 1,000 winners to her credit.
We're set for the Juvenile Fillies here in 1988, a million-dollar Breeders' Cup race. Let's go to Tom Durkin.
And they're at the gate for the Breeders' Cup Juvenile Fillies. Again this year, Wayne Lucas sends out a heavily favored 5-horse entry into this Breeders' Cup for Juvenile Fillies. Heavily favored here at 3-5, but this is a race that has had some upsets in the past. Epitome last year among them. They're in the gate, ready for the start. And they're off, and Coax Chelsea was off slowly a length. Also off a step slow with Seattle Meteor, and they pass us now for the first time. One of the Klein has asked for a run. Early Eloquent Minister is right there. And in between horses, Some Romance. So those 3 now will vie for the lead. Stocks Up has come out running in 4th position. Sequoia is now 5th toward the inside. Affirm Classic is running in 6th position early. Derby Shuffle has come away racing 7th. The Calumet Philly, Leah Lucinda, is now 8th. Seattle Meteor now goes to the outside for clear running. Then it's approved to fly toward the rail. Open Mind is next, and she is better than 15 lengths off the lead. Coax Chelsea a long shot, lags behind as they continue up the backstretch. Moving over to the half-mile pole, it is still
Eloquent Minister holding on to the lead by a length and a half. One of a Kind on the outside. Some Romance is now third. Gary Stevens asking him for more and run now, and she's moving through in between horses. Then farther back, Stocks Up now is asked for more run. Three furlongs from the wire. Sea Quay is now kept close to the pace. Just 4.5 lengths off the lead as they move midway around the far turn. Then it's Darby Shuffle next. Then farther back, Seattle Meteor is launching her bit from the back of the pack of Firm Classic. Leah Lucinda is moving to the outside now as the field turns for home. Some Romance now is sent through an opening toward the inside. Sea Quay is now set for the drive and darts to the inside. On the far outside, Seattle Meteor closing in. Leah Lucinda is also right there. Open Mind is moving through. Approved to Fly is also right there. And a Firm Classic. It is wide open. Anyone's race. Darby Shuffle moving into contention. Approved to Fly is there. Some Romance. Open Mind flying on the outside. Darby Shuffle. Open Mind now emerging with the lead. Darby Shuffle. Open Mind wins it going away. There were eight of them across the track at the eighth pole, and the Juvenile Fillies was decided in the final furlong. As Open Mind comes from off the pace, Cordero does it again.
Angel Cordero, light the birthday cake, get the candles out for Cordero. Back-to-back wins, first Gulch, and now Open Mind, and what a ride on this New Jersey bred, and those colors of Eugene Klein, and the combination of Klein and Lucas, again, collaborating for an apparent win. In just four career starts, Open Mind winning two and finishing second twice. Open Mind rallying down the stretch under the whip of Angel Cordero. Angel,
yeah.
Now how do you feel?
I'm tired. Very tired.
Where did you feel that your filly had a chance to win it?
On the eighth pole, when I finally got him around them horses, I thought she had a good chance to win it. First part of the race, I didn't think she was going to be on the board.
Do you have your eye on any particular filly?
Well, this is a nice filly, but I think these colors I'm wearing is helping. I'm 2 for 2, I don't believe it.
You're going to be with us in the next race.
You see the wind on the corner, but somebody's doing something right here.
Well, in the past, we've had Chris McCarron and Gary Stevens joining us, but they were injured. Well, we've got Angel Cordero as the third announcer in the booth today. Another win for Cordero, 2 for 2. Oh, Eugene Klein with his fifth Breeders' Cup win. And the fillies have been kind. The Klein from Rancho Santa Fe, California, Open Mind. And Wayne Lucas, the trainer who won with Gulch in the first race. Lucas had the top three horses with Darby Shuffle and Leah Lucinda following Open Mind. Let's go to Jay and Harvey.
Gene Klein, we have been unable to do this show without you any year. This is every year we seem to have you here. Now, when you've got as many go, you had Open Mind, you had Some Romance. Well, who did you watch during the race?
I watched all three of my fillies. I knew that the way the track was playing, the front-running fillies were going to have some problems. And Open Mind, I knew she'd come from behind. Whether she'd have enough to win it or not, I don't know. But Angel gave her a sensational ride.
Gene, here you are now. Look back in the pack. Look at Cordero.
Look at him come. Look at him come between horses. There's nobody does it any better than Angel in this situation. There he goes. He's got him moving. And she is a sensational filly. She almost beat Some Romance last time out. And I think she's now the best two-year-old filly in the country. She's beaten the best, the terrific field of horses, and I'm very excited to be up here with you gentlemen once again.
Fifth okay. time for you.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you. Gene Klein.
Angel Cordero, 2-4-2. Open Mind the winner, and that those colors are remindful of those that won the Kentucky Derby back in May, winning colors, Eugene Klein's three-year-old filly. Sharon?
I mean, now is Julie Crone, who had very nearly as good a race. Julie Crone becoming the first woman to ride in a Breeders' Cup race and finishing second. And anybody who had any doubts about your ability to ride in this company has got to not have them anymore.
Well, I think I'm riding for a few of the finest trainers in the world today, Woody Stevens and Mr. Wayne Lucas, and his operation is just like first class. And it's an honor to be considered, you know, possible, you know, capable to ride his horse and everything. And it's pretty thrilling to be here today, even though the weather's bad.
Interestingly, although horses have come off the pace pretty well today, including yours, and you usually don't see that so well on a track like this.
Well, the horses that have been going to lead have been going unusually fast also, so as far as considering it's a track bias, I don't think it's very fair, because I'm sure there's going to be some speed horses that hang on today, you know, just because of the bias. The horses that have been going to the lead are just stopping because they're going too fast.
Well, it's Julie Crone second in her first ever Breeders' Cup race.
Okay, that'd be good.
And a happy young lady she is, and you see the unusual numbers on the board. 1C, 1 and 1A, $340, $3, $280. You had to go all the way to the fourth horse to find your exacta at 1 and 2, and that was approved to fly. Those are the official results. Haven't cashed a ticket myself since Seabiscuit. Maybe my sources of information are wrong. Whom do you like in the upcoming distaff? We'll return to Churchill Downs after these words from your local station.
And here's Angel Cordero. It's Mr. Breeders' Cup today, Angel. It's all going for you, but it looks tough and dirty.
It is very tough. It's a big field here. It was hard to come through. But I'm having the greatest Breeders' Cup of my life. I only win one in 85, and now I win two. I feel like I'm in heaven.
And it looks to be difficult holes to get through.
It is, because it's a lot of horses, and the track is no help, and you can't see much where you're going, but I've been lucky so far. I think God is with me today.
And can horses work their way through this?
It's tough to get through on them, and especially if it rains again, but so far, so good. I'm going on a lucky streak.
Good. We'll see you later.
Okay.
Well, Cordero, who was 1-for-25 in previous Breeders' Cup races, is 2-for-2 in Louisville today. And the presentation trophy for the Breeders' Cup Juvenile Filly Championship, Warner L. Jones Jr., Chairman of the Board of Churchill Downs Incorporated, to owner Gene Klein, owner of the winner Open Mind. And perhaps we'll see her next May here at Churchill Downs in the Derby. Official and, order.
Yeah, it is. A 1-2-3 sweep for our team Lucas. Open Mind, Darby Shuffle, Leah Lucinda, 3 of the 5 in the Lucas entry. And as we look down the rest of the field, the way they finished, we'll see that Eloquent Minister, who we thought might run well, brought up the rear.
Well, at the races, the proper equipment, a program, a form, and binoculars, and it helps to have a keen race caller to help you to focus on the right horse. Our race caller, Tom Durkin, offers his tips on how to really follow the horses.
The racing form can tell you a great deal about how horses should perform during a race, but once that starting gate opens, almost anything can happen. Let's take a look now at a few key situations that I watch for as races develop. First of all, the start. Those first few crucial strides from the gate can set the tone for the entire race. Let's take a look at the start of last year's Breeders' Cup Turf, in which Angel Cordero was looking to get the early lead on a horse called Great Communicator.
Unfortunately for Cordero, there were some other jockeys who had the same idea. Great Communicator broke well and was hustled hard to get the early lead. A fast pace was established, and Great Communicator had no speed left for the finish. The start of the Turf Classic at Belmont Park was the exact opposite. No one wanted the lead, so Cordero, here riding Sunshine Forever, assumed the lead easily. As the other jockeys were taking back, Cordero sent Sunshine Forever to establish a slow early pace and went on to win wire to wire.
Every jockey knows that the shortest way around the racetrack is on the rail. But watch out, because these horses can sometimes get in trouble, especially if they're in behind tiring horses. Every jockey also knows that when horses get leg weary, they tend to do one of two things: bear in toward the inside rail or bear out. Well, if you're in behind them on the rail, you better hope that they bear out.
Here is Manila in the 1986 Breeders' Cup Turf and rail riding Jose Santos. Well, they didn't bear out in front of him, and Santos was forced to snatch his horse up and take him to the outside, losing momentum while altering course. Only a remarkable champion like Manila could overcome trouble like this to go on and win. In contrast, they did bear out for Freddie Head and Miesque in last year's Breeders' Cup Mile. It was a brilliant but daring race ride. Head saved every inch of ground till they entered the stretch and boldly sent Miesque through an opening. Had that opening not developed, Miesque would have been a Breeders' Cup also-ran, not a Breeders' Cup champion.
Well, jockeys communicate with horses in any number of ways, mostly with their hands. Sometimes they even talk to them, you know, words like giddy up and to that effect, but you really can't see them talking to the horses as a race develops. But one thing you can see is how a jockey uses a whip. Now, if he wants just a little run from a horse, he might show the horse the whip, run it up next to his head, or a light tap on the shoulder or the rump. But when he wants a lot of run from his horse, that's when he goes to the whip in earnest. It's the jockey's way of saying to the horse, I want everything that you have, and I want it now.
And when now is before they near the top of the stretch, it's a bad sign. Craig Perrett, riding Bet Twice, fading into third, resorted to the whip early in the Meadowlands Cup. The eventual winner, Ali Sheba, moved by under a strong hand ride. Here's the Travers Stakes with 49er on top with Chris McCarron. At the top of the stretch, McCarron was hand riding 49er. In mid-stretch, he showed the whip to the horse. Then he gave him one good whack on the right side, and then he waited till the final 16th to go to a vigorous left-handed whip, to which 49er responded and won.
Well, Tom, in the distaff coming up, there'll be plenty to watch. Some talented fillies. Epitome, who won the juvenile fillies a year ago, a long shot as part of an entry here. Winning Colors, who won the Kentucky Derby here at Churchill Downs, part of the number two. Lucas entry is at 3-1. Goodbye Halo at 5-1. But, of course, the morning line favorite at 2-5, the unbeaten filly, Personal Ensign.
Back to our equine power words, and this sport indeed exudes beauty, synonymous with the thoroughbred and its environs. Churchill Downs in 1937, Kentucky Derby. Triple Crown winner, War Admiral, the son of one of the greatest racehorses in history, Man of War, part of the heritage of breeding and racing here in the Commonwealth of Kentucky. Well, since the start of this day, now live after 3 o'clock in Louisville, dark skies and light rain is falling once again. The track is sloppy. Speed is not holding, it's getting deeper, and that may bode well for those horses that like to come off the pace. And as we look ahead to the next million-dollar race, the Breeders' Cup Distaff, let's see if we can't find some inside information. I wonder where Greg Lewis is.
All right, thank you, Dick. Well, Woody Stevens, you are 5-for-5 in the Belmont, and you are 0-for-4 in the Breeders' Cup, but you have a very big race coming up for you, and that is the Classic. How is 49er, and how do you like the weather?
He's fine. I think he'll handle this track perfect. He's run well in the mud. He won the Sanford in it last year, and I thought he ran awfully well. He's doing well now, and his last race has been very good.
All right, and what about Julie Crone? Obviously, you're very happy with that decision. She's got a second here already.
She's rode this horse one time, and I was so pleased. I thought she rode him as good as he could be rode. He ran far, and he seemed very happy, and I'm happy to have her.
All right, have you looked at the distaff here, and have you got any picks coming up?
Not really. I just feel I'm waiting for these two races I run in. I'm in the seventh with Posen, which he's won 5 stakes over the grass this year, and he's run awfully hard, and so is 49er. So I think this is the first year that I've run horses in the Breeders' Cup that I have a chance.
All right. Well, we'll follow that story. Right now, let's go back to Dick Enberg. Dick?
All right, Greg, no information there. Doggone. Well, we do have some added information for you. The track is getting slower, deeper, as we go through the race program of this day, and it's now... The condition of the track has been changed from sloppy to muddy. Muddy now as we await the distaff. And Personal Ensign will have to run through the mud, going for 13 straight wins.
She is a special filly, Dick, and she has run in the mud twice. Needless to say, she won both those efforts because she is unbeaten in her 12 career starts. That's really an amazing thing because she has 5 surgical screws implanted in her left hind leg. This was the injury. Do you see the break in the left hind leg? And surgery was performed, and the surgical screws were implanted. She is coming up to the final race of her career today, and she has done all this while racing with the surgical screws. You see the process that implanted the screws that hold that fracture together on her left hind leg.
Well, she has a date, does she not, with the Mr. Prospector in the breeding barn next spring.
This will be her final race. She'll be retired to be bred to the leading sire, Mr. Prospector, beginning next spring, Dick.
Ruff Scott?
And a fascinating thing for us, Lenson, because she is unbeaten. When did the last star horse go right through a career unbeaten? We haven't had one in Europe since Rebo 30 years ago. And here in America, Colin in 1908, 80 years since a star went through unbeaten. This afternoon is going to be the final test.
They're on the track for the $1 million distaff, and here are the ladies.
Number one is Epitome. The upset win in the Breeders' Cup Juvenile Fillies last year propelled her to an Eclipse Award, but in her first start as a three-year-old, she suffered a deep leg cut that sidelined her for 6 months. She has two wins and a disappointing second since her return. She teams up with Pat Day, just like last year. The other half of the Phil Hauswald trained and John Bell-owned entry is Hayla Cab at five, the oldest horse in the field, earned a trip to the Breeders' Cup by winning Keeneland's Grade 1 Spinster at 25-1.
And here is the Kentucky Derby winner from last spring and May, Winning Colors, but she's not won in four starts since.
After that grueling Triple Crown series, after becoming only the third filly to win the Derby, she took a couple of months off. In two races back, she was second to Personal Ensign, but then was a very tiring fourth in Keeneland Spinster. The other half of the Lucas entry is 2B Classic Crown. Slow to mature, she has two wins this year, including the Grade 1 Gazelle. Lucas says she deserves a chance to try to win today. Number three, Goodbye Halo, winner of four Grade 1 races this year, including the Kentucky Oaks here at Churchill Downs. Trained by Hall of Famer Charlie Whittingham, who won the Classic with Ferdinand, now retired last year. Goodbye Halo won five of her first six before losing her last two. Number four, Shamsay, took seven in a row to begin her career, has never been out of the money. Both times those that she faced Personal Ensign, she lost by six lengths. Number five is Willa on the Move, bought for $750,000 this summer by Ronnie Lamarck, the singing co-owner of Risen Star, the now retired Preakness and Belmont winner. In addition to leading cheers for Willa on the Move, Lamarck is in Louisville lobbying for Risen Star to be the champion three-year-old of 1988.
Yeah, they compare Personal Ensign, do they not, with that great filly Ruffian who won her first 10 starts.
In fact, there are those that say Personal Ensign is better than Ruffian was. She is truly one of the greatest racing fillies of all time, and bidding to retire undefeated, the first American major stakes winner to retire undefeated in 80 years. Owner Phipps and trainer McGahee hope for lucky win number 13 in her final start today. Number seven, Integra, in the money 8 of 10 this year, but she hasn't won since May. By the way, just one little note, trainer William Helmbrecht is from the same town as Wayne Lucas, Antigo, Wisconsin.
Yeah, they're watching there with interest indeed. Well, it's a two-horse or two-filly race, if you judge by how they're betting. Epitome and Hale Cab, the entry at 11-1. The Kentucky Derby winner, Winning Colors, the second choice at 9-2, along with Classic Crown in that entry. Goodbye Halo at 6-1, getting some support. Sham Say 45-1. Willa on the Move 18-1. And Personal Ensign, who has never gone off worse than 6-5 in her previous 12 starts at 1-5. Integra at 80-1. Welcome back to Breeders' Cup Day at Famed Churchill Downs in Louisville. Our third $1 million race coming up the distaff for nine fillies and mares on the dirt track at a mile and a quarter. Post position shouldn't be a factor. Plenty of track going to the first turn. Speed isn't enough here. This is a test of stamina and courage, and the focus, of course, will be on number six, Personal Ensign, now at 2-5, going for the 1988 Horse of the Year. Strong implications there. And now, as we look at this distaff, their race behind the race insights. Let's go again to Jay and Harvey.
We get some insight into the distaff as we spotlight Personal Ensign, simply the best, undefeated. This is her 13th start. She's a remarkable racehorse. Here's Winning Colors, this year's Gallant Kentucky Derby winner.
disappointed in the spinster at Keeneland recently. She came back after 3 months' rest to go against Personal Ensign in the Mascot at Belmont.
If Winning Colors is on the muscle today, we may not just be seeing a coronation of Personal Ensign. We may be seeing another great matchup. Here she is in front at the top of the stretch at Belmont Park. Personal Ensign is going after her. You'd expect Winning Colors to collapse, but she doesn't. Here at Churchill Downs, speed is even better than it was that day at Belmont Park. But Personal Ensign is rarely denied. She never runs a bad race. She's one of the greatest. And if she wins the distaff today, she's racing into history.
Personal Ensign has taken on the very best, and she's never let down her talented trainer, Shoot McGahee, who works for the famed Phipps family. And he has a way with the ladies.
One of the things we did do was go back and look and see people that could be filly trainers. It's very important for us that a trainer can train fillies, and as you know, very few trainers can train fillies over the course of time. We are not buyers at sales. We are producers of our own broodmares. Therefore, you have to have a record on the track.
Our Personal Ensign looking for something that has not been accomplished by a U.S. horse in over 80 years, winning the first 13 starts of a career, and this will be the last, and possibly will say goodbye as Horse of the Year. Pax Pool, well, the latest, he lost $2 in the juvenile filly, so down to $73. I wonder if he's going to go for the odds on favorite.
Well, we'll find out. You know, here in Kentucky, there's a lot of sentiment today for Winning Colors because of the Derby victory here, but there is Personal Ensign. I mean, can you say?
We're looking at a strange racetrack. It was sloppy, now it's muddy. Speed is not holding up as it has been the past few days. It's a treacherous racetrack. It may not even be a true one. But as for my bet, I'm taking this race to Texas.
To Texas?
You ever been to El Paso?
You're going to pass, huh? No bet in Pax Pool as we get set for this one. He is passing.
That's what I like, a man with heart. All right, they're approaching the starting gate, and in that location is Bruff Scott.
Yes, it's a super moment here. You can see them out at the back there, and Personal Ensign, I haven't, of course, ever seen her before, and what a beautiful, strong filly she is. And also Winning Colors, I haven't seen her, so it's very exciting. A Kentucky Derby winner. She was very much on the muscle when she came down here, very wound up and ready. And no doubt she'll be charging out as they come through. Anyway, there they are, beginning the file through towards the stalls, and I must say I'm impressed now with how quickly they load here. They go in, they load, they know their business. In Europe sometimes we get a little bit finicky and take quite a bit longer to install.
This race is at a mile and an eighth. In previous Breeders' Cup, it was over a mile and a quarter. It's been shortened up this year, partly because of the suggestion of Wayne Lucas, and it'll be a Lucas horse, Winning Colors, in post position eight today that figures to show the early speed. Winning Colors figures to come away on top. That's the way she runs, and her running style, of course, not conducive to this track that we see. The real stretch runners here will come from the inside. Epitome in post position one, and her entry mate, Hail a Cab, who is in post position four. Those two figure to take back early, although being on the inside, they might have to use their horses just a little bit to get position before they settle into stride. But look for Winning Colors in post position eight to set the early fractions here.
And those Winning Colors are those of the Gene Klein stable. It's interesting that Wayne Lucas, who has won this Breeders' Cup race, the distaff, the last 3 years with Life's Magic in 85, Lady's Secret, remember, in 86 at Santa Anita, and Sacagawea last year, he's already won the first two races today, and he has Winning Colors going now.
And Winning Colors, of course, is the first Kentucky Derby winner to return to Churchill Downs since Dust Commander in 1970.
Now we're looking at these fillies and we think they've got to be pretty miserable out there in the cold and the mud. Well, that's projecting on horses the way we feel out here right now. Horses don't mind it being cold. They feel energetic and they tend to run pretty well. They also don't mind the mud. Given half a chance, they'd lay down and roll. Now what some of them do mind is insecure footing. Now as the rain continues this afternoon, the danger of insecure footing increases, so some of these fillies may not like that.
On a muddy track, nine fillies and mares ready to go. Let's go upstairs to Tom Durkin.
Personal Ensign has taken her place in the starting gate, and she will certainly take her place in history as one of the greatest fillies of all time. She seeks to retire here undefeated, the first major American horse to do so in 80 years. There is a Derby winner in the field in Winning Colors who seeks to stop her streak at 12. And they're up in the distaff. Goodbye, Halo. Broke well in Winning Colors now. She's going to run right on the lead early. Well, on the move has come out running in third, and she's taken in hand. Integra now has been gathered back in fourth position as they head for the first turn. Personal Ensign was away in good order now. She'll be floated a bit wide going into the turn by Sham Say. Epitome is saving ground all the way on the inside. And then Classic Crown is one horse beaten, and that is Hail the Cab as they round the first turn. And the Derby winner is Loose on the lead. It's Winning Colors now, and she's opened up by 4.5 lengths. Goodbye, Halo is second, and Vasquez asking Sham Say for run now third toward the inside. Willa on the move is racing in fourth. Integra is fifth on the outside. Personal Ensign, the undefeated filly, is now 9 lengths off the lead as they continue up the backstretch. It's still Winning Colors, Loose on the lead by 2.5. Sham Say is running second. On the outside, Goodbye Halo in striking position is third. Willa on the move is asked for more run fourth. Personal Ensign is still 8 lengths out of it. There's a half mile to run, and Winning Colors doing what she did in the Derby. She's still free running on the lead. 3 furlongs to run, and she leads now by 3. Goodbye Halo beginning to pick it up in second now. Sham Say is third toward the rail. Personal Ensign is putting her run in on the inside now, and she takes to the outside. 5 lengths off the lead of Winning Colors, who turns for home here at Churchill Downs. Stevens going to a vigorous left-handed whip, holding on by 2. Goodbye Halo is charging hard. Here comes Personal Ensign, unleashing a furious run on the outside, but it is still Winning Colors. Goodbye Halo. Personal Ensign, a 16th of a mile from the wire. Winning Colors is there. Personal Ensign, a dramatic finish, and here is the wire, and it is Personal Ensign there with Winning Colors in a photo. Very close at the 16th pole. It looked like Personal Ensign was facing her first defeat, but in those final 110 courageous yards, she certainly proved herself a champion this afternoon.
Oh my, the photos will be interesting and studied closely. Was it Winning Colors in the lead all the way, or did Personal Ensign catch the Derby winner at the wire? This is the NBC unofficial photo finish camera, and from our camera, unofficially, Personal Ensign has retired undefeated, 13 in a row for this great filly, bred in Kentucky and ridden masterfully by Randy Romero. Randy Romero, what are your thoughts as you came down that final furlong?
Talking to you, Randy.
Randy, your thoughts as you tried coming down the stretch, that long quarter mile stretch here at the Derby, going after the Kentucky Derby winner, Winning Colors.
What was your thoughts?
Oh, it's the greatest feeling of my life. I've always dreamed to have an undefeated horse. I got it. And I'm glad it's over.
Do you think you won it?
Yes, I did.
Well, our cameras, from our angle, you did, and now it is official. Personal Ensign has won the distaff and maintains a brilliant, unbeaten career, retired, and will be bred to Mr. Prospector in the spring, and there she is. One of the greatest fillies of all time now. We can write that story.
And what a way to go out with a courageous effort. It didn't appear that she had a chance an eighth of a mile from home. What a courageous effort, too, for Winning Colors on a track that does not favor speed.
Randy Romero said that this is the best horse that he has ever ridden, and she shows her heart today in this muddy track at Churchill Downs with a brilliant rally down the stretch to catch Winning color by a nose at the wire. And let's go back to the head of the stretch.
Goodbye Halo beginning to pick it up in second now. Sham Say is third toward the rail. Personal Ensign is putting her run in on the inside now. She takes to the outside. 5 lengths off the lead of Winning Colors, who turns for home here at Churchill Downs. Stevens going to a vigorous left-handed whip, holding on by 2. Goodbye Halo is charging hard. Here comes Personal Ensign, unleashing a furious run on the outside, but it is still Winning Colors. Goodbye Halo. Personal Ensign, a 16th of a mile from the wire. Winning Colors is there. Personal Ensign, a dramatic finish, and here is the wire, and it is Personal.
And it is now official. Personal Ensign, the winner, paid $3, $2.20 to show, and $2.10, 5 cents on your dollar to show, winning colors at $2.80 and $2.20, and goodbye Halo finishes third at $2.40, exact a payoff of just under $10.
Dick, a magic moment, and for Ogden Phipps, you said you didn't think he was going to get there.
I didn't think so. She looked to be in trouble.
This has got to be a wonderful 13th victory for you. 13 out of 13, a man who has spent his life hoping for something like this.
She is certainly great to me.
Harvey?
I have Mary Jane McGahey, the trainer's wife, who cried after the race. Mary Jane, have you worked this filly?
No, I've never ridden her. I go with her in the morning on the pony.
Well, if you look there, and I don't know about any of you, we thought she was beaten. I have Denny Phipps here. Denny, you said that McGahey handles fillies well. How did you feel now?
He handles them great. He did a wonderful job with this filly always, and she's just been a great filly and trained by a wonderful person.
And even you weren't sure of the margin of victory, were you?
No, we were at an angle and we couldn't tell.
Mr. Phipps, look at this move. The horse on the inside, now coming to the outside, and a distant fourth.
That's right. I was scared there. I didn't think she was going to get it.
Randy got into this horse, and she really started to pick him up.
Yeah.
Which leads right there.
She changed leads in mid-stretch. She didn't change them until then.
At the eighth pole.
Then she starts to really move. This is a very good way to go out before she goes back to Claiborne to be a broodmare, right?
Yeah.
And now you can look forward to getting the babies.
Exactly.
Congratulations all around, sir. Oh,
thank you very much. Jay, thank you.
And with the trainer, Shug McGahey, Bruff Scott.
Harry.
Yes, Shug McGahey, many, many congratulations, Shug. What a filly.
Thank you. It was a great race. I thought she was hopelessly beat the 3/8 pole, which shows what a good filly she is to be able to overcome it and win.
I've, of course, not seen her before. She seems terribly, terribly brave.
She is. She's a very, very good filly with a lot of courage.
Well, she caught a game filly in winning colors, the Kentucky Derby winner, and it was a incredibly patient ride by Romero, who saved his filly and had enough left, just enough to catch her at the wire. What a race. Personal Ensign, 13 straight wins, retires unbeaten. Well, the track, according to Pet, offers an interesting juxtaposition for those who dare to wager the lesson painfully learned. This is a place, you know, where the windows can clean the people. Three down, four Breeders' Cup races to go after these words from your local station. It's a gray day, but we've just seen a brilliant race, a magnificent effort by the unbeaten Personal Ensign. Randy Romero with a ride, and he's with Bruff Scott.
Randy, we've just heard Shug say that 3/8 he thought he had no chance. What did you think?
Well, I was getting a little worried, but I didn't get discouraged in my field. I know she makes a hard run, and I knew from when I got to the 70-yard pole I was going to get her.
You actually knew you'd get that, did you?
At the 70-yard pole, yeah, because the other mare was getting back a little bit, and my mare, she was just keep running. She kept running, you know. And I knew I was going to get them from the 70-yard pole to the wire.
It's an extraordinary thing to run 14 races undefeated. What's the secret for Personal Ensign?
She's determined. She's one. There's one in a million. You can get one like her, and she's the one. And what's so good about her, she don't want to get beat. She's determined to get the job done, and that's what she did today.
It's been great to watch her. Thank you.
And the official order of finish time.
Well, Personal Ensign showing us her courage, and it is an amazing, no matter what the conditions, the Breeders' Cup always produces drama. Winning Colors had one of the great races of her life as well, and goodbye Halo, who won the Kentucky Oaks here at Churchill Downs, finishing third. You see the remainder of the order of finish in the distaff. Personal Ensign, one in a million, said Randy Romero. She certainly is that.
Well, it's appropriate that a great lady in the Commonwealth of Kentucky, former Governor of Kentucky, the Honorable Martha Lane Collins, should present Ogden Phipps with a trophy, the Breeders' Cup Juvenile Championship, and that will be a filly that we won't forget and a race to be remembered often in the future.
I know I'll remember it. And how do you criticize perfection? A personal ensign to me is probably wrapped up Horse of the Year honors. It depends on what Ali Sheba does in the Classic, but she hasn't lost, and she certainly showed us her courage today. Racing, by the way, for only the second time in her career outside New York on a track that she may not have liked.
Of course, in the Classic, the $3 million race that will be the climax of today's activities at Churchill Downs. We'll see how Ali Sheba does. Ali Sheba beaten by a nose, Ferdinand, last year in the Classic, and it was a thrill last year, as or earlier here, as it was last year, to see that magnificent finish. Many watching our telecast today are at other tracks, wagering on Breeders' Cup races from thousands of miles away. Last year, over $22 million were bet on Breeders' Cup Day at simulcast centers. In many ways, off-track betting has been racing's lifesaver. And with a report, Ruff Scott.
Besides the traditional on-track betting windows, now fans often can wager at off-track betting shops, at intertrack facilities, a network of tracks within a state showing races from one location, or at simulcast locations, usually one track sending a major race to many others. Like the Laurel Sports Palace in Maryland, where fans have access to a bank of computers and a video replay center to enable them to better handicap the races, even when the live action is at Pimlico. Or like the lavish Winter Circle shops, dining and betting facilities operated by a consortium of Illinois tracks, like this one, which opened nearly a year ago in Rockford.
Horse racing is wonderful. We all love it. But the people that go to the horse races are the people that like to bet. And the people that like to bet on whatever is most convenient. And OTB is what makes horse racing as convenient as its competition. And that is a must.
Racetracks once feared off-track betting. Critics charged that if fans could watch and wager close to home, why would they bother to come to the racetrack? Tracks would simply become empty television studios, they said. The critics have been partially correct. At the New York Racing Association tracks, Aqueduct, Belmont, and Saratoga, attendance is nearly half what it was the year before off-track betting was introduced. But because of the increase in purses generated by additional revenue, racing is prospering in New York. Intertrack wagering has been responsible for the revival of a declining Maryland racing circuit. An average of over $600,000 is wagered daily at the Laurel Sports Palace on races from Pimlico. And the combined betting figures from the two tracks is up 25% from last year. As a result, purses also have risen at the same level.
Our purses are up an equivalent 25-30% over what they were in 1987, and it certainly provides our horsemen and those people who are investing in this business a true light behind the tunnel that, by golly, there are sufficient dollars, even in a state like Maryland, that you can run for.
However, what appears to be positive growth from a business standpoint may be a negative for the sport. Off-track, inter-track, and simulcast wagering may be simply making it more convenient for existing bettors without creating any new racing fans. But can racing exist without the dollars generated by these fairly recent forms of wagering? That's the dilemma facing racetrack executives in the not-so-distant future. Like it or not, a satellite dish at the track and some form of off-track betting has become as important as swift horses for the successful future of thoroughbred racing.
Ruff Scott, simulcasting as a concept actually began in Great Britain some 30 years ago. Now, what has been the long-range impact since it first started?
I don't think there's any going back, Dick. I mean, it's now 95% of all wagering in Britain is on off-track betting. The only trouble is that we think they're different audience. They don't actually go to the track, really, off-track bettors. But, of course, what you've got in the States, you're already locked into a much bigger deal of rake-off from off-track betting than we get in England. We get less than 1% in England. That's been our problem.
Well, of course, racing not only brings out the outstanding fillies and mares and colts and stallions, but it also brings out some of those people that are easily recognizable and stars in our society, and with one of those is Greg Lewis.
Thank you, Dick Enberg. Well, I'm with Walter Cronkite, and he is antsy to get up to the betting window, and I know you're an expert at analyzing races between Republican elephants and Democratic donkeys, but how about horses?
I'm about as good at that as I am with Republicans and Democrats. I haven't won one of those for a while either.
How have you done here today, and what about in that last race? Did you have personal ensign?
No, sir, I didn't. Yes, I did. I did have personal ensign in the last race. That's right, I did. But I was had more money on other horses.
Well, maybe it'll get better later. Thank you for joining us, and go to the window to place that bet. Vic?
Well, there's no question of the electricity, the excitement of a day at the races, tens of thousands cheering and enjoying, but this is also a sport that enjoys its special moments of solitude. Throughout Churchill Downs in 1955 Kentucky Derby, it was Swaps, the surprising invader from California, the winning jockey, the great Bill Shoemaker. Next up on today's Breeders' Cup program, the Mile Turf Race. Three of the previous four Breeders' Cup Mile Turf races have been won by horses that have raced in Europe and with a British eye toward today's race. Here's Bruff Scott.
And behind me is a horse called Hilton Brown. Now, you won't find him on your race car, but he's very important because he is the companion, travelling companion of the British champion, Warning. He's been with him on the travel over, he was with him on the track, he was with him right here while he was saddling, and Warning is very relaxed, and the Warning against Miesque is indeed the European champion mile run here at Churchill Downs, Kentucky.
Well, seven races today. We await the midpoint in a great day at Churchill Downs. The sprint won by Gulch with Angel Cordero. Wayne Lucas, seventh Breeders' Cup win. The trainer paid $13.40 coming from behind. And then the fillies, Lucas again training the 1-2-3 finish, Open Mind. Another great ride by Cordero to win. Derby Shuffle with Julie Crone. And third was Leah Lucinda. And the Distaff, a truly superb race. The word great will be used often, but perhaps really belongs as personal ensign with Randy Romero. Noses out the Kentucky Derby winner, winning colors in the final strides, paying $3.13 for the filly personal ensign, now retired. And they're on the track now for the first turf race of the day, one of two that we'll see, the Breeders' Cup Mile. And often this is a race that decides the European championships. We have a champion, Miesque, who won the mile last year from France. And Warning from Great Britain is the top miler there.
Always one of the most wide-open races, Dick. And on the average, the mile has had the longest price favorites on the entire Breeders' Cup program over the first four runnings. And the European contingent is strong again this year, perhaps the best ever. The top two horses at a mile in Europe are in the field for the Breeders' Cup mile today. Number one is Blushing John, part of the entry conditioned by France's top trainer, Francois Boutin. Winner of the classic French 2000 guineas in the spring, he's been fourth in three Group 1s since then.
There's Miesque, 1A, trying to repeat her win at Hollywood Park last year.
That win made her America's champion turf mare. This year, she's raced only three times, winning two Group 1 races in France and losing by a head in the other. One of those wins was over Warning. She won't return to France. She'll remain in Kentucky to be bred after the race today. Number two is Posen, appears to prefer this mile distance and will lay just off the early pace, trained by Hall of Famer Woody Stevens. Number three, Bet Twice, winner of the 1987 Belmont Stakes. He's had a great rivalry with Ali Sheba, but owner Bob Levy elected to bypass his old nemesis in the Classic and go here in the mile. Winner of over $3.3 million, Bet Twice was third in both starts on the turf. He retires after this race. Number four, Steinlin. Wayne Lucas has not trained many turf runners in the past. This is his first horse in the Breeders' Cup mile. Steinlin has won three of four at a mile this year, his only loss on a soft turf course he didn't like. Number five is Ravenella, the three-year-old filly who enters this race off a victory in Laurel's All Along Stakes a couple of weeks ago, her first U.S. start. Winner of two classic races, the English and French Thousand Guineas. She has been beaten only twice in nine lifetime starts. Number six, Simply Majestic. Here's an interesting long shot. He's broken or tied three track records this year, including his last start, a wire-to-wire course record effort on the grass at Calder. Dangerous if he makes an early lead. Number seven is Muhammad Abdu, an ordinary performer in Europe. He's been sensational in the U.S. for trainer Dick Mulhall. His only loss in six races here was at a mile and a half. 2 weeks ago, he set a course record at Santa Anita, winning after a six-month layoff. Number eight, Niccolo Polo, got his first graded stakes win at Keeneland last month, but he looks to be outclassed, probably shouldn't be in this race. Number nine, Mill Native, gave a rousing course record performance over the turf course at Woodbine to win the Arlington Million, his first U.S. start. In Europe, though, he was unable to beat the top milers.
And here's the one the fans here in Louisville have been waiting to see, Warning, considered the top colt in Europe, running this mile.
His five-length win in Ascot's Queen Elizabeth Stakes, said to be Europe's top performance of 1988. He's the fifth Breeders' Cup horse trained by Guy Harwood, who says he's learned the closer to the race that you come over, the better. This horse got here on Tuesday. Winner in three of four starts since a virus in the spring. Warning, by the way, is the betting favorite in England. And Master Christopher, another American horse that appears to be in over his head, trained by 25-year-old Michael O'Neppe, who has had his license only 3 years.
Let's take a look at the current odds. We're just moments away. Flushing John and Miesque, the entry. The favorite at the moment at 2-1. Posen, Woody Stevens' horse, 16-1. Bet twice. Getting some solid support. The long shot, Steinlin. Ravenella, 18-1. Good price for Ravenella. Simply Majestic. Mohammed Abdu, 14-17. Niccolo Polo, 22-1. Mill Native at 8-1. The winner of the Arlington. And Warning, the favorite at the moment at 2-1. Master Christopher, 80-1. They'll run on a course, a turf course that is considered firm at the moment, a firm course for the mile. Action at Churchill Downs moves to the 7/8 of a mile turf course. $1 million, 12 are entered in this mile run. Plenty of track into the first turn. Turns here are sharp and will favor the more athletic horses. 1 mile, $1 million at stake. The turns, like an automobile racetrack, are banked in the corners. It's interesting to note that the grass is 90% fescue, and you guessed it, 10% Kentucky bluegrass. The course is just 3 years old, built so that Churchill Downs could attract this Breeders' Cup day. And now for the mile run on the turf, a preview.
It's a World Championship mile here in Louisville today, and here's the defender, Miesque. Won the Breeders' Cup mile at Hollywood a year ago, and since then has raced lightly, winning two of three in 88. Here's Miesque's arch rival, Warning. He's won 7 of 9 in his career. We're going to see him as he hooked up with Miesque at Deauville in France in August. And Guy Harwood brings this horse to America with another chance to win a Breeders' Cup stake.
Now, this race at Deauville makes you think that Miesque should be the logical winner. She's on the left, Warning in the center. They went very slow. It turned into a sprint, and at a sprint, if this turns into a sprint, she'll win. Look at this speed. When she stretches like that, she's unbeatable, and her connection thinks she'll win again. But Warning is only a three-year-old. He's improving all the time. His last performance was at Ascot. It was a Group 1 race against Group 1 horses. It's uphill. Just look at the power of this little horse. Only a little run. I think he's improving so much, I think he'll beat her. These are the best two milers in the world. But shocks happen in racing. Mill Native paid $83 when he won the Arlington Million. He's now with Charlie Whittingham, and he could do it.
European riders don't like to rush out of the gate. American jocks do. Trainer John Paracel on this long shot, Simply Majestic, has the best gate rider in the country, Angel Cordero Jr.
Well, sometimes the best bets are the ones you don't make. Harvey Pack didn't lose in the last. He now has $73 and looks at the mile.
And we'll get your thoughts, Harvey, about this one.
I wouldn't have lost if I had bet. I don't take favorites. This race course, the turf course here, was designed by the same gentleman who did Woodbine, similar to the Woodbine course. So I'm going to go with a horse that ran well over the Woodbine course. We're going to go with Mill Native. 20 to win on Mill Native, what do I care?
A lot of sand underneath the grass here. Very firm. It's hard to believe with all the rain. I like Mill Native, too.
Well, the course condition is firm, and that is a bit surprising, and perhaps Bruff Scott can fill in the formula.
Yes, everyone thought this would be soft, if not heavy. We had an inch of rain, but it's on 14 inches of sand. And the more it rained, the more the sand underneath this actually packs down. I ran around it this morning. You can actually bounce off it. It's officially firm now. You'll certainly ride fast. It might be quite on the turn, it'll be quite loose, and they'll be really motoring. Incidentally, warning, drawn on the outside, just one from the outside with Mies 3 inside him, but Pat Edery, who rides warning, said he didn't mind that because he'd always have the mare covered, but it'll be some sprint at the end.
Don't go away, Bruff, don't go away. You are in the best position to give us some insights on these two, the great, the horse and the filly here, Miesk, and warning, we're going to make you pick one.
Well, I went for warning in the pick, but the more I've looked at Miesk and the more I've seen her action again, she's got such brilliant speed, and she'll pull and run up to the turn. I think she might just pick him off, but I think this is the greatest certainty for an exacta we've ever seen.
Bruff, one thing that is really an unknown is the European horses racing over this turf course, which is rooted in the sand. I was talking to Pat Day before the races today, and he said some horses just feel like they're spinning their wheels when they run on it. It'll be an unknown factor.
And there are still five horses to go. 1A, Miesk, ridden by Freddie Head last year for the Breeders' Cup Mile Championship, trying to repeat. They're about set. Let's go to Tom Durkin.
The best miler in France, Miesk, squares off against the best miler in England in warning. He's in the starting gate now. Miesk, the winner of this race last year at Hollywood Park in record time. An outstanding international field, one behind the gate. Master Christopher from the outside. He's moving into the starting gate now, and we're ready for the Breeders' Cup Mile. They're in the gate. And they're off. Bet Twice breaks alertly. Steinland was also out fast. Simply Majestic has hustled away. And Master Christopher now sprinting up from the outside to grab the early lead. It's Master Christopher now who goes on with it. Simply Majestic is gathered back in second. Mohammed Abdu is away well in third position. Steinland is fourth toward the inside. Niccolo Polo on the outside now running in fifth place. And Ray Vanilla now sixth toward the rail. And she's hustled up. Blushing John is now racing in seventh. Miesk was three wide round the first turn. She's now 10 lengths off the lead. And then it is Mill Native, followed by Belmont Stakes winner Bet Twice. Warning has one horse beaten, and that is Posen. Warning is 15 lengths off the lead of a free-running Master Christopher. He leads by three lengths now, halfway through the Breeders' Cup Mile. Simply Majestic kept within striking distance. Second, Steinland tucked nicely along the inside in third. Mohammed Abdu is now asked for run, and there he goes. And Niccolo Polo is moving with him. And Miesk is now moved within 4.5 lengths of the lead. It's a gap of 6 lengths to Ravenella and Warning, who's just beginning to get in the way. They're coming to the top of the stretch now. Niccolo Polo on the outside. Simply Majestic toward the rail. Those two are head-to-head. And here comes the French filly, Miesk, charging hard on the outside. Steinland is now fourth. And now they're down to the final furlong. Miesk is charging hard to take the lead now. She's looking for back-to-back wins in the Breeders' Cup Mile. And she's leading by three and pouring it on. Pulling away impressively here. Miesk has won it. Oh, Miesk, what a filly. And Freddie Head does it again. Absolutely sensational. He knew he had a tremendous filly underneath him. He wasn't concerned early. And she gunned down this international field in the stretch with an explosive stretch rally. And Warning really never got underway. He finished far back.
So Freddie Head aboard Miesk, 1A, the four-year-old Kentucky-bred filly. What a great miler she is. Becomes the first to win back-to-back in Breeders' Cup competition. 1987 by 3.5 lengths at Hollywood Park. Her only U.S. appearance at that time, acclaimed the top grass female of the year in 1987, the Eclipse Award, and she's back, and what a day for the ladies. Personal Ensign and Miesk back-to-back, two brilliant runs. Freddie Head, can you compare the race by this filly today with her winning effort at Hollywood Park last year?
How was her effort today?
Oh, it was great. She's a real fantastic mare.
You're going to lose her after today, are you not? This is your last ride on Miesk.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're having trouble with our microphone out on the backside. Freddie had, it should be interesting to fans that aren't close to racing, Tom Hammond, how out of breath the jockeys are, the energy in a minute and a half, 2 minutes expended in these vigorous rides.
Just controlling these 1,000-pound animals going 35 or 40 miles an hour and pushing them to the finish does take great athletic efforts. Freddie Head, the Frenchman, triumphing once again on Miesque in the Breeders' Cup Miles.
Steinlin and Simply Majestic following.
Pat Eddie, who was covered in mud, very disappointed, Pat. Any explanations?
Well, he couldn't get his grip. He just kept slipping all the way around. He just couldn't handle it. It was too much for him.
Once you obviously, just to play the viewers, you were on warning. That's Guy. Sorry. It's Guy Harwood.
Very disappointed.
Guy Harwood there. Obviously also very disappointed. He got the replay.
Miesque with another powerful run to take the Breeders' Cup Mile. Here she is. She will make her run on the outside, and she'll come clear into the stretch and will be pulling away through the stretch run on this mile course. And she has proven now 2 years in succession that she can handle the tight turns of American racing, the tight turns of the turf course at Hollywood Park, and today the tight turns here at Churchill Downs. Undoubtedly will be voted again the champion turf mare in the United States off one U.S. performance. Here she comes on the outside running down Nicolo Polo. Look at the ease with which she takes the lead and blows by those two, and as they come to the wire, Freddie Head just keeping her mind on her business with a left-handed whip, and she draws away for an easy victory here. She is much the best of this mile field.
138 and 3, that's nearly 6 seconds slower than the run at Hollywood Park. Of course, this turf a slower course at Churchill Downs today, but a brilliant ride again.
A year ago, when Miesque was a winner in California, Stavros Niekross couldn't be here. He's here from Switzerland to watch today. You must have enjoyed this.
Well, I enjoyed very much. I love the track here and the place, and I will come every year nowadays. From now on.
Your daughter is also with you, Harvey. She was here last year.
How come you showed up last year?
My daughter takes care of all the racing.
All right.
She's the big boss.
You have about 50 in training now?
Exactly.
We're going to show you, and you can watch your charge in action here. We've got an isolated replay.
Wonderful.
What were your thoughts at the head of the stretch?
What do you think?
What are your thoughts at the head of the stretch?
Well, the head of what?
What were you thinking here?
Did you think she'd win?
Now, oh God, fourth. Fourth of the line, fourth. Now we're carrying on, we're coming up. We're coming up. I think we're going to make it.
It looks pretty good right here, doesn't it?
Yeah, it looks very good.
At this point, we could have written
looking
that.
Before, it was even better.
Where's she going, to breeding now?
Very much.
Is she going to the breeding shed?
Yeah.
Okay, we'll be looking for her get to win future Breeders' Cup.
Nice to have you.
Yes, a back-to-back
winner.
Well,
I hope to see you next year again and win again.
Good.
Miesque, for the second successive year, is champion of the Breeders' Cup Mile. She paid $6, $3.60, and $3. Steinlin from the Wayne Lucas stable, a long shot, was second, $20.20, and $8.60. Simply Majestic, $6.80 to show. The Exacta paid $138.80.
Now she'll be writing her own book after retirement. And the first chapter of his book was written in 1964. Kentucky Derby winner and sire superior to be, Northern Dancer. And what a story it was and is. Welcome back, and the magic of historic Churchill Down. On racing's richest day, we've just seen Miesque, the brilliant four-year-old French filly, win for the second time a Breeders' Cup Mile after her Hollywood victory last year. And she now will be retired, sent to Claiborne Farms in the spring, and will be sired by Mr. Prospector. He's going to have some nice girlfriends next spring,
is
he not?
Big day for Mr. Prospector, also the sire of Gulch, who won the sprint today.
And Personal Lenson scheduled to go there as well.
That's right. Here is the official order of finish for the mile, with Muhammad Abdu finishing fifth and Posen sixth after we saw the first three a moment ago. One of the stories of the race, Warning, who went off as the 9-5 favorite, was eased, and perhaps, like Pat Day said, some of these horses feel like they're spinning their wheels on this sandy course. Maybe that was the case there.
That's the mayor of the city of Louisville, the Honorable Jerry Abramson, presenting the winner's trophy to one of the wealthiest men in the world, the Greek shipping magnate Stavros Niarchos. Louisville, Kentucky. The very words as they roll out of your mouth, unless you're a Louisville Cardinal basketball fan, just conjure up racing and Churchill Downs and the excitement of that first Saturday in May. It'll be the 115th running of the Derby in 1989, and perhaps one of the colts we're about to see in the juvenile will be involved. The crowd estimated at over 70,000 fans here at Louisville today, and in their midst is Greg Lewis.
They came in limousines and luxury sedans, and only rainstorms stopped them from arriving in private helicopters. They were European royalty, American aristocracy, the titans of thoroughbred racing, 265 guests who already held a Breeders' Cup winning ticket, a coveted invitation to Mrs. Cornelius Vanderbilt Whitney's Thursday night gala at the legendary family farm in the heart of thoroughbred country, Lexington, Kentucky. For three generations, over two centuries, the Whitney name and their Eton blue and brown silks have been synonymous with racing excellence.
My husband has raised more stakes winners and bred them than any other living American, and I think that's quite a record. I mean, need I say more?
Guests toasted the Whitney legacy with champagne chilled in a silver bowl won at the 1906 Belmont. But unlike Mary Lou Whitney's traditional theme gala held during the Saratoga season, this party was a first, celebrating the Breeders' Cup debut in Kentucky.
We're immensely pleased that the Breeders' Cup is in Kentucky. We're going to work hard to keep it here. Kentucky gave birth to the Breeders' Cup. Folks like John Gaines and others that promoted it. The Breeders' Cup belongs in Kentucky, and we're going to work hard to keep it here.
A sentiment no doubt echoed by Mrs. Whitney's guests, many more famous than the horses they will bet on, from commentator Walter Cronkite to comedian Tom Smothers, to Kentucky's former First Lady and Miss America, Phyllis George, and her husband, John Y. Brown.
Well, the party is continuing here on the fourth floor of the clubhouse. Mrs. Whitney, a great evening the other night. How is the day going for you here?
Well, we have a winning table. Almost all of my guests are winning, and really, it's just been a fabulous day for us.
Are you happy with the Breeders' Cup and the way? We don't have the best weather, but do you think Kentucky is pleased with the way the Breeders' Cup's going?
Oh, I think, really, it's excellent, and, well, a little weather doesn't bother any of us. We're having a wonderful time.
Very good. All right, Dick, let's go back to you.
Okay,
good.
Greg, thank you. Trainer Claude Shug McGahee is an old-fashioned Kentucky bred. This laid-back and modest 37-year-old native of the Bluegrass State has seen his personal ensign win a thriller today, and now McGahee has the favorite 2-year-old colt Easy Goer coming up in the juvenile. He's been the right man in the right place, and I guess today is his time.
The 1940s were the glory days for Calumet Farms, a family-held stable whose domination was unmatched, with horses like Whirlaway and Citation winning Kentucky Derby. But by the 60s, such stables were in decline as a major force in racing. But today, the Phipps Stable, one of the few major family-held operations around, has achieved a modern miracle in thoroughbred racing. Let's compare this success to a college basketball team. The freshman class tries out, 5 of them will be All-Americans. With but 26 horses in the stable, 5 are racing here at the Breeders' Cup in the black and red silks of the Phipps Stable. The man the Phipps family credits with much of their success is their trainer, Shug McGahee.
We try to breed the best stallions to the best mares. We try to feed them well. We try to give them all the tender, loving care. Shug has certainly had a lot to do with it. And his race record this year, his training record, has been phenomenal. I can't remember a training record like it.
Shug is almost like a member of the Phipps family. In fact, he lives right on the Phipps estate.
The Phippses have been absolutely wonderful at trying to make Mary Jane and my family at home. We've got a very nice place to live. We participate with them in a lot of things.
This family man feeling separates him from other trainers. His responsibilities are exclusively to the Phipps horses. This is in complete contrast to trainer D. Wayne Lucas. His operation covers just about every major track in the country, more like a coast-to-coast conglomerate than a family business. In fact, Shug met his wife, Mary Jane, at a track in Kentucky, and they came to the Phipps stable as a package. Mary Jane is an exercise rider for the Phipps stable. Although Lexington is the breeding ground of great equestrian talent, the Phipps family lured him from the fields of Kentucky to the fast track life of New York. Although Shug resides a mere 20 minutes from Times Square, it's stretching it to call him a New Yorker.
It's fascinating in there. If I knew more about New York City, I'm sure that I would enjoy it. I know there's a lot of wonderful places to go and a lot of wonderful places to eat, but it's amazing to watch all the people, the different things that are going on, but I just don't know that much about it. I think the afternoon that I went in there, I went to 52nd Street, 7th Avenue, and came back on the Verrazano Bridge, which is probably about 50 miles out of the way.
Soon after their arrival in New York, a third member of the McGahee clan came along. At 2, Chip has already taken responsibilities for his horse Levi's in his own way, but as he gets older, no doubt his horses will be younger and faster. In the shadow of Wall Street, where big business rules the roost, the Phipps family puts their faith in a small family from Kentucky.
Shug McGahee, a native of Lexington, Kentucky, trained for many years on the Kentucky circuit here at Churchill Downs. This could be his biggest day ever. Already a win with Personal Ensign and the trainer of the favorite in the juvenile coming up. In fact, here are the morning line odds for the $1 million juvenile. And the Lucas trained Is It True is the third betting choice at 8-1, but the favorite will be Easy Gore, already mentioned among some of the greats of racing history, 2-5 on the morning line.
And each of those 10 colts carry hope for today and already for them, hope for the Kentucky Derby next spring. The power words in racing, and this four-letter word defines so much of the future, and it's shared with winners and non-winners.
Easy Gore as he heads to the racetrack, and you can really see from this position, one thing I can't keep up with him, but also why he is the horse he is. Look at the muscles on the hindquarters of this horse. He was a little difficult to saddle and put Pat Day aboard. I think it means that he just feels good. There he goes out onto the track. Easy Gore, the heavy favorite to be both the two-year-old champion and the winner of this race.
They've reached the track, these 10 fine young colts, but no question about the heavy favorite, number 9, Easy Gore.
Let's take a look at the field now for the Breeders' Cup Juvenile. Number 1 is Music Mercy, a Canadian-bred horse who was raced exclusively in California, won the Grade 1 Del Mar Futurity. He bled while finishing 6th in the Norfolk Stakes, and today, for the first time, races on the anti-bleeding medication Lasix. 1A is Mountain Ghost, the other half of the Craig Lewis-trained entry. Goes to the post here despite a troubled 10th place finish in the Young America Stakes 9 days ago.
And here's the Wayne Lucas-trained colt, Is It True? Lucas already with 2 firsts today and 3 seconds.
Is It True? Named that because he couldn't believe he got him for only $525,000. He was so grand-looking. Lucas has scored, remember, wire-to-wire wins in the last 2 Breeders' Cup Juveniles, Capote in 86, Success Express last year. Number 3 is Double Quick. Had the early lead but faded in his only try around 2 turns. Trainer Mel Studio, though, has had a pair of previous Breeders' Cup winners, Very Subtle and Brave Raj. Number 4 is My Hair Is Red. Yes, his hair is red. Or chestnut, if you want to get technical, except for a few white hairs on his forehead. He's your Cinderella horse, a winner in all 4 starts, but raced in Washington and Montana. Moves up to the heavyweight division today. Number 5, Dr. Bizarre, an Ohio bred, has never raced outside his native state. He won the Best of Ohio Stakes last weekend, the second Breeders' Cup ride for Julie Crone. Number 6, Leading Prospect, has the most starts, 11 of any horse in the field, but has only one win, not exactly a leading prospect. Number 7, Tegel, Kentucky bred. He's raced in France and is 2-for-2 there. He'll race on dirt for the first time today, though he has trained on it. Should like this distance. He's already been a mile and an eighth. Number 8 is Into Bucks, a Florida-bred colt who comes into this race off a pair of fine two-turn stakes performances at Calder. A slight foot infection earlier in the week has cleared up. He'll be ridden by Jose Santos, leading money-winning jockey of 1988. Number nine, is Easy Gore, who's already being compared to many racing greats. He was bred to be a champion. He's by Ali Dar from the champion mare Relaxing. He lost his first start by a nose after trouble at the gate, then reeled off 4 in a row with incredible time.
Sam, I saw you talking with Shug McGahey's wife, Mary Jane, a couple of days ago, and you were talking about Easy Gore.
She's his exercise rider. She says he's a bright horse. He likes to stop and eat on the way back from the track after morning exercise. And she said, to take it all his favorite restaurants on the way home.
Yeah, there are the current odds, and there's no question about the favorite of this big crowd at Churchill Downs at 1-5. Personal Lenson went off at 2-5 as she barely won and remained unbeaten 13 in a row. So looking ahead, the Derby colts of next year, Easy Gore, much the favorite. We'll soon see how he performs. Well, this race does epitomize that word hope and promise. 10 two-year-old colts entered in the $1 Million Breeders' Cup Juvenile. Same course the two-year-old fillies took earlier. Remember, Open Mind, Gene Klein's filly won the juvenile fillies. A mile in the 16th, Easy Goer in the 9-hole, not the best post going into a relatively quick first turn. Look at past performance. Here's Jay and Harvey.
In this juvenile, the question before the house is, can anyone beat Easy Goer? We doubt it. Easy Goer is the only multiple stakes winner in the field. His only loss was his first start when he was wiped out at the gate. We're going to take a look now at the Champagne, a mile at Belmont, 3 weeks ago.
Horses can lose. They're not machines. This will be his first time around two turns today. But what you're looking at is a horse that actually makes me speechless. He is a professional racehorse. He is awesome. Watch him along the inside now. Looks like just any other racehorse. He's about to come in under Pat Day. He's going to make the lead. But watch the way he does it. Watch the fluidity of his movement. This is what a racehorse is supposed to be. This is what Walter Brennan meant in the movie Kentucky when he said, this horse has the look of eagles. This horse has the stamp of greatness on him. He's the best two-year-old we've seen since Devil's Bag. Now watch Pat Day. He's going to tap him lightly with the stick. May have hit him one time more than he had to. But this horse doesn't care. He's learning. His ears are back. Every race is an experience to him. He's probably going to be the favorite in the Kentucky Derby if he wins today. You may be looking at one of the greatest thoroughbreds in history.
Well, Harvey Pack may not be winning, but he's still talking. $20 on Mill Native in the mile turf. Mill Native went unplaced, and it's down to $53, but the real player, that's the way they like it, coming from behind.
And, Dick, 3 races to go for the Walter Brennan fan. What are your plans?
Humiliated in public again. Well, let me explain something about Easy Goer. I'm in love with Easy Goer, as I was with Personal Ensign. I cannot bet against this horse. I used to have a friend who loved the New York Knicks basketball team. Whenever he went to the games, he bet against them, so if they lost, he could go home with a few bucks in his pocket. I'm not that rotten. I will not bet. It's going to El Paso again.
There are the current odds, and we remind you, Harvey, that if you have anything left at the end of the day, you can't keep it, you know. It comes back over to NBC Sports.
They never told me that.
The current odds, the entry, Music Merci and Mountain Ghost at 7-1. Is it true? The Lucas trained colt at 8-1, Double Quick at 40-1, and Hair is Red. What a great name, 15-1. Dr. Bizarre at 22-1, Leading Prospect, an outsider at 50-1. Tegel, good support there for the European colt at 8-1, Into Bucks 40-1, and Easy Goer now at 2-5.
We've had a bit of a drama concerning the European entry, Tegel. because he got very upset when he was being saddled when they were putting the cross noseband on him. He has a little bit of an abscess in his mouth which showed up this morning. He reared right over backwards and was so upset that trainer Francois Boutin has taken the cross noseband he wanted to use off the horse. If you look at his nose when you get closer to him, you'll find he has no noseband on. He's a talented horse, but it's very difficult for Europeans, first time on the dirt and first time, in fact, on the slop. But if he runs up to the possibilities, he might even come back here for the Kentucky Derby.
You know, Brooke, the horse we're all looking at, of course, is Easy Goer, and it's hard to tell which horse is going to capture the public imagination, and Easy Goer certainly has. Performance is part of it, but also its appearance and personality. You know, I saw Easy Goer when he was 3 weeks old in a field at Claiborne Farm in Kentucky. It was this little red horse who zoomed up to the camera and said, "Take my picture," essentially. He got in the way. You know, I thought then that this little son of relaxing was going to be a good horse. He captures the imagination because he's got the looks, the personality, and boy, does he have the racing record.
The early speed in this race figures to come from the inside post positions, post position one and post position two. These should provide the early speed. Is it true is in one and double quick is in two. We'll all be watching, of course, for post position nine. That's Easy Goer. He should settle in just off that early lead as they work their way through the stretch for the first time.
Well-bred Easy Goer, the son of Ali Dar, gets his name from the dam side. Mother relaxing. Easy Goer, already being compared by the Eastern media to the great Secretariat.
You know, he was foaled at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Most foals are born late at night, but perhaps that accounts for his exceptional ability, even though Shug McGahey, his trainer, didn't think he was the best of his two-year-olds initially, but he has convinced him since, and Easy Goer certainly has a lot of reputation to live up to. So far he has.
How will he like the track, Tom?
Well, he has worked well on an off-race track. Mary Jane McGahey, who gallops him in the morning, says he should have no problems.
So these colts already, Easy Goer, the odds on favorite at 2-5, and the pre-Kentucky Derby favorite for next year. He's about to run. Here's Tom Durkin.
6 months from today, they'll place the starting gate a furlong and a half up the track to start the 115th Kentucky Derby. And this fifth Breeders' Cup Juvenile will go a long way to determine the early favorite. Easy Goer now, 2-5 in the gate, and they're off. Music Mercy broke like a bullet, comes right out for the lead. Double Quick is going to run with him early now, and Double Quick is there. Is It True is hustled away from the gate as the field moves into the first turn. Is It True and Double Quick down, those two run at each other early. It's 2 lengths, my hair's red. Saving ground on the inside third. Music Mercy is alongside fourth by two. Into Bucks came away in fifth position. And then his leading prospect, who's in hand, racing in sixth. Easy Goer has settled in seventh place now. He's about 8 lengths off the lead as they make their way onto the backstretch. The trailers are European Tagle, Dr. Bizarre toward the inside, and the early trailer is Mountain Ghost as they continue up the backstretch. Is It True on the inside? With heavy pressure from Double Quick, those two moving at a demanding pace as they continue up the backstretch. Maher's Red is trying to stay with those two in third. Leading prospect now has asked for more run toward the inside. And Music Mercy now is putting in his run as the field moves into the far turn. Then it's into Bucks. And now Easy Goer starting to find his stride. Tagle is alongside him. Those two are now 7 lengths off the lead of Is It True, who has turned back the early challenge of Double Quick. But on the outside, the Californian Music Mercy now looms boldly in second. And Easy Goer now continues the gain for the back of the pack. 6 lengths off the lead as the field turns for home. Tagle is floated outside him. They're set down for the drive. Is It True? Full out now to hold off Music Mercy. And Easy Goer looms boldly now, a threatening presence on the outside. They're in the final furlong. Is It True? Pink Eye all over him. Easy Goer closing on the outside, a 16th from home. Is It True? Trying to hold on. Easy Goer can't get to him. It is It True who goes on to win it by a length. Easy Goer is defeated in front of the back. It was Tangle. Pink Eye went to that strong whip, his trademark in the stretch, and got Is It True home to win the fifth Breeders' Cup Juvenile.
Well, our first major upset of this Breeders' Cup day, and when you look up Breeders' Cup trainer in the dictionary, you're going to have that man's face. Wayne Lucas has done it again. The hat trick for Lucas. 3 wins, and he's got 3 seconds, and with a Gene Klein-owned Is It True, a Kentucky bred, raced only five times with just one win prior to today, but what a win it is! Upsetting Easy Goer.
Here you go.
Lafitte Pinkai, is it true? Did you think you had that much of a horse?
Did you have that much horse? Did you think you had that much horse?
Well, they were coming at the end, but he was trying, you know. He was getting a little tired too, but he was trying.
Easy Goer, did you have any idea how close the favorite was?
What is it?
Did you know how close Easy Goer was?
No, I know he was coming.
The designer silks that have become a popular item here of late, do you really believe they make a difference?
Well, it might. They put it good. They probably caught the wind pretty good. And it may be because a lot of the horses are doing good.
Lafitte Pinkai getting his by the gate quickly and holding off the charge of Easy Goer. And Gene Klein and Wayne Lucas celebrate again.